So closing out of that. Ah, I'm so excited, everybody. I've been working on this course forever. I am so stoked. It's been, I don't know, over a year for sure of working on material and honing in on this whole Master of the Mix principle with Evenant. And I'm like, today's an awesome day. So I'm glad we're hopping on here for a live Q&A. I'm down to talk about all things mixing, mastering, industry, whatever, you know, I can like legally talk about, and we'll have fun with all of that stuff. But I wanted to start out first playing a mix that I did recently came out. I did not master it. My buddy Adam Grover at Sterling Mastering did it. But I think it would be a fun way to start this whole live Q&A. This track is just like, it's so much fun. It has so much energy, cool vocals. The music video is freaking wild, and you guys should totally, totally go watch that. Yo, what's up, Ricky? How are you, buddy? I see. So I have the chat on the side, so I'm going to be looking over here a bunch. But let me start out by playing this mix, and we'll just like jam it, and let's get into answering some questions. So the song's called Break Me. What's up, Sam? And it's by a killer artist named Maggie Lindemann, and it's featuring Sick Brain. And yeah, let's just play this real quick.
Every time you try to break me, I feel my heart decaying. Every time you try to break me down, taste you and I breathe so deep. Heartbeats hard, my knees go weak. Mouth glued shut and I can't speak. Why does fear make me complete? Killing me. Every time you try to break me, I feel my heart decaying. Every time you try to break me down.
Yeah, so just a little bit behind that track. I mean, it's like very aggressive, very distorted, subline. The producer's name, No Love. The extended name is No Love for the Middle Child. He's freaking awesome. But the whole thing behind that is like coping with the highs and lows of addiction. So it's really distorted. The bass line is just like slamming, you know, I mean, it's just got this cool distortion to the whole track, and as a mixer, whenever you like receive a track like that, it already has like a cool vibe. Like it's already, you already know what the track wants. And as a mixer, you know, I'm supposed to lean into that and bring out the best of what that song is supposed to be. So I had a freaking blast with that track. So let's see, I'm looking through some of the questions so far. Okay, so Michael Jones said that whenever he posts, or whenever he posted the link for the first assignment, it didn't hyperlink. Yeah, I'd love to figure that out. That's obviously something that we'd love to have is hyperlinking. I can even take note of that. Let me take notes on my phone. Also, if anybody has any questions about that track in particular that I played, I'm super down to answer anything. Hyperlinking. Okay, I took down that as a note. I'll definitely talk to the team about that. Sergio, so we actually have a full section on hybrid orchestral mixing. So I mean, I'm not sure if you guys know, but I've been in the trailer world as either a composer, a producer, a mixing and mastering person for since 2018, mid 2018, and you know I've mixed a serious amount of trailer music for many, many different companies. And some of the publishers are still coming in. So I'm going to start mixing music for a new publisher today. And, you know, I've done everything. I feel like every genre in trailer, ads, promo, but I also do tons of pop and alt rock and hip hop. So it's kind of all over the place, but in this course, I solely focus on giving a framework that will work for any genre. It's not genre specific. It is works, I'd say workflow specific. It gives you like, this is what I need to do now. This is what I need to do now. These are the tools I should use. This is how I should use those tools. It's like the full framework of how to mix and master. And then it allows you to kind of figure out what your own style and sound is. You know, like, what does your ear like? And then you can use the tools that I give you and the framework that I give you to hone in on your sound and what makes you a, you know, a mixer, a composer, a whatever. So I hit hybrid orchestral. I hit a pop mix that could kind of skew indie pop. So it gives you kind of two genres there. And then a hip hop track that also, I don't know, that it's not just like your average hip hop. It's got really cool atmosphere and humongous bass. And then also, if you get this course, it's going to include my mastering workshop and also my low-end management tightening kind of workshop. And then in those, we also cover like synthwave, some other hybrid orchestral. So it's kind of all over. It just like blankets. I wanted to make sure and not, you know, leave off some genres that you guys might be interested in. But I'm also interested in a possibility of in the future doing other genres for you guys. So, you know, in the group chat within the course, please just like say, hey, I'd love to learn how to mix, you know, whatever. And I'd very much like to dive into that. Evan, this course 100% is for anybody who's either a full-fledged beginner or, you know, all the way up to, I think that if, you know, an incredible mixer, somebody who's doing, you know, great work very consistently, I think that everybody can learn something from this. Now, I think that somebody who's at the very top of the game, they might take some, you know, one tip here and one tip there, just like I would if they put out a course. But for more of like the beginner intermediate, I think that this is going to be life-changing. It sets up a framework for beginners that, you know, if you have your track, here it is right here, and we print out those, that multi-track, those stems, whatever, and put it into another, like a mixing session, it's going to give them a workflow. Like, this is what we do first. This is what we do second. I mean, it really holds your hand and walks you through the process of how to mix a track from start to finish. And for intermediate people that already are putting out, you know, decent mixes, this is going to give them consistency from one mix to another. Because that's, as a mixer or a mastering engineer, the only thing that I feel like matters is our consistency. So if you know what I sound like as a mixer, you know that if you have a track that I would sound good on, you can send it to me and you know you're going to get something consistent back. The worst thing I think a mixer could be is somebody who is kind of all over the place. They haven't figured out their sound. They haven't figured out their workflow. So from mix to mix to mix, you have no idea what to expect back as a client. Or, you know, if you are a composer and you're not consistent, your end client, your publisher, you know, they're going to get a product that's never the same. And so this will help with the consistency. Let me go back. I saw one question here about somebody. Let's see. Okay. Sage Rebel. You said one of your biggest issues is that your mixes don't translate from system to system. So this is a multifaceted question, and we absolutely dive into it in the course. And I really think that I can help you. You know, if you're at a 1 out of 10 on translation, this will take you to maybe a 6. You know, I think it's going to take you a huge way there. What's up to you is that if you use monitors, there are two things. One, you should be spending, I hope all of you take notes on this, and I talk about it in the course. If you have decent monitors, your money should go to your room treatment. It shouldn't go to better monitors. It shouldn't go to some crazy wild gear. If you want to make your mixes sound better, without a doubt, your money should be going to the absorption in your room. That's like bar none where your money should go. If the treatment in your room is really absorbing the low end, it's absorbing the high end, it's pretty dead. Like for mixing, my room, as you can see, it has absorption everywhere. Absorption over my head, absorption over my head in the back, in front of me, entirely absorbing. There's not really any reflection. There's no reflections in my room. Out of frame, I have a little gap between my two clouds, which is the only thing I really want, and above my traps so that the room isn't so dead that you feel weird in here. But that will help your mix translate to other systems. And then two, if you have that, you should get subs that are worked into your system. And in the course, I give information to a guy named Gerhard Westphalen, who's the acoustician who really set up my room. Subs are incredibly important. I have two of them. I have stereo subs because that allows me to have the low mids still come out of my speakers, because low mids are directional. They're not omnidirectional. 80 hertz and below, or 60 hertz and below, we can't really hear where it's coming from. It's just there. But above that range, we can absolutely locate where that sound is coming from. And so if you have two subs, it allows you to have a really low crossover. And that way you can have your low mids coming out of your speakers. So what I'm getting to here is room treatment, and then having subs, or if we scrap all of that, having a great pair of headphones with something like Sonar works so that you can always hear your mixes in the same headphones and know the EQ curve, that's going to be huge. And then I do two different tests. One is over my iPhone speaker. I just have it on my desk and I use the Audrio app. I think that's how you say it. And I just stream straight to my phone speaker and I listen out of that. And if there's too much low end, you can tell because the music will start breaking up. It'll start distorting and it won't feel very powerful coming out of the speaker because it can't handle the low end. So it just like craps out. And then I use Apple iPod Pros. I think that the only thing that I really dial in on those is the top end. I love those ear pods. They are so, so, so good. But if things sound harsh on those, that definitely means your top end or the 3 to 6K area is too pokey or the, you know, it's too bright because those headphones are not bright whatsoever. Like nothing ever hurts my ears done by a pro mixer. So I think that those are two great ways. I do not use my car. I know a lot of people do that. I just don't. It doesn't provide me anything that those other two can't. But I do have a really, really dialed in studio. Okay. Let me go back through some of these questions here. What tools are needed for the course? Sergio, in the first module, I make a list of, I'd say, pretty much all of the plugins that I use. There might be a couple here and there that I use that aren't on that list, and that's totally fine. The reason that I may have not put them on the list is maybe there are new plugins that I'm just using, you know, I'm just trying out, and they have not made it into my workflow. But I do have discounts and student discounts. And then I do have a couple affiliate link plugins, ones that I use every day, though. I'm not putting anything in there to make money off of a plugin I don't use. They're all in module one, and I explain how to use all of them. And then you'll see me use each and every one of them in my mixes that I do live for you. So in this course, one of the cool things, I've never really seen this done, and that's what I wanted to make sure to do here, is that I mix three tracks from absolute scratch. There is not a single plugin, no volume change, no automation, no nothing. And I go in there and I mix it in real time. You hear me mess up. I try things. I delete them. I go back on some things that I say. I do this thing and then I get into the mix. And I'm like, you know what? That whole thing that I spent, you know, some time on is not really working for me. And then I go back and I show you why I change it. Where I think that a lot of other courses take like a big well-known track or something that's already done. And then you have the instructor go back in and they're like, this is what I may have done, you know, whenever I was mixing this track, or these are the plugins that I used and settings that I used at that time. But you don't really get to see why they did it, how they did it, why is that, you know, what they came up with, where in the process that happened. So I really, really made conscious effort to show you every single thing that I do and why I do it. And then I dive into how I'm doing it. So I covered all the bases there. Okay, great question on Break Me. So the question is, it's deceivingly empty, but still a busy mix. How do you decide which elements to bring out in front? Is it your call or is it Maggie or Sick Brain fully involved? So as a pro mixer working, if you are a mixer that's always working, people keep on coming back to you for what you do best. One of the big things that I have to keep in mind is, as a mixer, this is not my track. I may be great at my job. I might have, you know, great ears. I might have been a producer, a composer, or a writer, any of this, you know, previously. So I know a lot about production. I go into it with like zero ego at all. I listen to the rough mix. The rough mix for me means the producer, artists, the artist manager, the label, whoever has said, yes, that track is great. We love that. It's ready to go on to mixing. So the worst thing that I could possibly do is not listen to that rough or not try and be close to that rough, because now I'm saying all of the people that I'm working for, their ideas of what this track should be are wrong. So there's two things. If I'm sent a mix like I was, or this track from No Love, I know, like, just by listening to it, it was already awesome sounding. So my whole goal is just to overall make this track tell its story better. The story for me was the lows, like the low energy moments, need to be really subdued and like kind of floaty and take you to this new kind of world, which in this song is the good feelings of being addicted to drugs, I believe. It's like the calm moments of addiction. And then the chorus needs to be in your face, absolutely energetic, you know, get hit with a baseball bat in the face, basically. And so I just needed to tell that story better. So, or to the best it could be. And really, I just like went in, thickened things up, made that sub, you know, really slam in my car that has subs. Whenever I cruise around town, I listen to that. It sounds freaking awesome. It sounds like a humongous hip hop record with the low end. But I just made sure that all the elements have their own space and they're as thick and as full as possible. And then for anything that I do of Maggie's, which I pretty much mix the entire new album that's coming out in September, she really likes her vocals forward. And I mean, she's got a great and cool voice. So we put that front and center. I think he said he loves my nail polish. I don't know. I used to bite the hell out of my fingers. And one way to deal with that was to put nail polish on them. But then I also just like the way it looks. I always do matte black. All right. Let's see. Next question here. Michael, in the first module, you mentioned not wanting to receive plugins in your stems. Are you saying that you want the plugin baked into the stems? Michael, yes. So absolutely. That's a great clarification to make. So whenever I mix a track, I do not like seeing what plugins a producer or a composer or whatever had on their stems, or, you know, on what we'd call the multi-track. If I do, sometimes I work with producers that want to send me a session, like an Ableton session or a Pro Tools session. That's cool. But for me, I'm a tinkerer, so I would go in and I'd want to manipulate each plugin and just like fine tune them. And that is like the antithesis for me of a proper mix. I want to take your track, your inspiration, your vision, and I want to elevate it. So whatever plugins you have on that track, I want to keep that baked into the stems. And then I want to elevate that. Some of the really great producers that I work with, I'll shout out Cody Tarpley here, a good buddy of mine. He worked on Maggie stuff, not Break Me, but the other tracks. His stems, whenever he sends them to me, it's his multi-track, because it's usually over 100 tracks. If I keep them at zero and I just press play, it sounds identical to his rough mix. He's really great at that. So I know that I'm just elevating his track. I'm not having to rework it. That is where I'd love to be. I don't like getting plugins on tracks. And if I do, I'm just going to print it. I'll get stems and then I'll elevate it from there. All right. Sam said, I always struggle with mixing vocals. How did you get those vocals to sit well in the busy, loud track on the first track you played earlier on the stream? So here there's, and we go deep into this in the course. My buddy Rowland, we did a track of his. He's got a freaking amazing voice. He's great at vocal producing as well. So his stuff comes in awesome. But for me, okay, so I mix the entire track without vocals first, like in a chorus. I want the music to be as thick and full and as storytelling as possible. And then I actually go back and put in the lead vocal. And so what I do is I carve a little bit of frequency space in the instrument, like whatever is sitting in the vocal kind of range and in the center of the mix. But then from there, what I do is on the lead vocal itself, you know, I'll do serial compression. I use Vocal Writer sometimes, or a lot of the time actually. And see, that's one of the plugins that I left off of that list. And I could go, you know what? I'm gonna make a note here. Vocal Writer. Unless I already have it in there. I'll check Vocal Writer to plugin list. So I use Vocal Writer. I think it's a great plugin. It doesn't use compression. It rides volume to make sure that it's more constant. Okay, but from there, I use a multi-band compressor that actually gives character in certain like frequency ranges. That's kind of part of my sound. I've dialed in this MIC DSP 4-band multi-band compressor that, while, yeah, it's adding some compression, it adds some excitement to my vocal, and it's kind of like, I'd say, a signature of my vocal sound. But then from there, this is where I think the real juice is that I use parallel, I guess we could call it widening. I don't really use parallel compression at all on vocals. What I do, though, is I use parallel widening, and so I'll use an H3000 on a 3% and a 9% setting, which I go over in this course. And I just work in a little bit of the mid-range it back into the vocal. So you have your vocal, lead vocal here, and then I add a little bit of width into that, and then a little bit more width, which is the 9%. And it just makes this wider vocal, but you don't hear like any chorusing. You don't hear multiple vocals. It just sounds like a thicker, wider vocal. It's some crazy stuff. Like it's hard. I don't know the specifics of why that works so well, but it just sounds like a thicker, wider vocal. And as long as you take off the low end and the high end, it just kind of hovers there, and you have no idea it's there. And on top of that, I use one more chorus, and that is the Dimension D plugin. I think it's Arturia. I can't remember. I think it's Arturia. And I don't know if I have that on the list, but I could do that. Dimension D. My real thing is I don't want you guys to have to spend a ton on plugins. All these things could be done with stock plugins, like a chorus. You could just use a stock chorus. And what I do with that is, again, I just push it barely into the vocal whenever I feel any volume change at all. I might back it off just a little bit, and that's it. It's like all of these vocals in parallel just adding up onto one lead vocal that makes it feel like the middle of the mix. Okay, so then like once I have that, not talking about effects or any of that, I will use Spectre, which is it's like a parametric. It looks like a parametric EQ, but it's a saturator, and you just choose where you want to saturate. And it's so clean and pure, and it's just amazing. I will figure out where the vocal sounds happy with a little bit of saturation. This could be anywhere from like 1K to 6K, somewhere in there. And I will just give it a little slight boost. And boom, it cuts through the mix. It sounds wide, got power. That's how you make a dry vocal sound amazing without verb and delay and all that. I mean, that's a whole other discussion. But so it takes all of that to make a great vocal, in my opinion. And some vocal producers are just freaking incredible, and it comes into me and I don't need to do all that. But that's typically how I would treat a vocal that I want to sound great in a mix that doesn't. And then at the very, very end, I would have Suze on that probably. Okay, mix bus for trailer music plugins. What would you suggest? Sergi, I actually dive into the nitty gritty of setting up your mix bus in my course. So just to keep it like a broad overview, basically what you need to have a great mix bus. Your mix bus, in my opinion, should be the exact same over all genres. That it's the mix bus does not determine my mix. My mix bus determines how loud I can get my mix, because I bake everything into the mix itself. My mix bus just needs to be able to handle me getting to -6 lufs and writing there, because that's, I mean, pop music, rock music, all we're living to 6 to 7, like -6 to 7 lufs. So you need some kind of plug-in to push volume or take away volume in your mix chain. An EQ. I use a multiband compressor. I use a clipper. And then I use a brick wall limiter. And then after that, I just have something that's telling me how loud my track is. I go into the real nitty gritty of what the plugins are, what the settings are, and everything in the course. All right, Sage Rebel. I produce and mix, so I often mix as I go. I assume I can use these principles from the course for that too, instead of starting from dry stems. Sage, of course, you totally can. The thing that I would say though, is that I know this is a blanket statement, and you can always get burned for blanket statements, but I want to say that you're always going to get better results from your mix and master if you do it in its own session. And this is why I print down all plugins and I don't want to see them. Just being able to transfer your brain from the right side of your brain, the creative side, the side that wants to tinker and go back and change things about the track, and moving into a more of a left brain, kind of analytical, this is what I need to do, this is how I need to do it, this is the way I want it to sound, let's get there. Yeah, I'm still right-brained. I absolutely am still creating in my mix, but without the ability to go back and change things that have been done, you're just moving forward. So I'd really, really highly suggest, if you can, moving the project over to a mix session. If not, this course will still absolutely help you get to your goal. It can all be used in the same project, as well as like a custom trailer. This all works for that. This is how I mix custom trailer music that myself composed. This is the same exact thing. So it does work. I've made placements off of it. All right. Now I'm caffeinated. Let's go. Let's see what else we got. Mateo, if there was one track that you could choose a reference for an amount of reverb in a cinematic orchestral track, what would it be? Oof, that's difficult. Mateo, I have to tell you that I don't really listen to trailer music. Like, I don't go onto Spotify and listen to trailer music. If I were to be honest, like, I would say that the track that I mixed for this course, I think it sounds pretty incredible. It's hard for me to really answer that one. I've personally mixed definitely over 1,000 tracks in the trailer world, in just like the trailer space. So I don't really listen to other trailer mixes. I just do my thing at this point. If you take this course though, the track that I do in there is, it sounds pretty awesome. It's a song that's published by Songs to Your Eyes. I would say that track is pretty damn good. It's a great representation. Eben asks, how much time do I usually spend on a mix? So it definitely depends on how many tracks I get in, but 2 hours or less is generally what I take. And the reason for that, it actually takes that long. It could take less time, but I always have like this mix prep that I do. I always take out silence. And since Ableton can't remove silence, which is kind of a pain, I have to do it by hand, which is totally fine. But 2 hours. And the reason for this is that if you're taking more time than that, then you're getting too nitty gritty, too in the weeds. You're losing the overall idea of what the track should be. Even if I have to really dive in deep and make something out of a track that doesn't have a lot, I can get there quickly because I have a framework. I have set tools that I use. I don't deviate from, I have like a batch of plugins that I use because I know what they do and I know how to manipulate whatever signal I'm given with these tools. Yeah, I do experiment from time to time with new plugins, but it's very rare that something does something incredibly new that I don't have in my workflow. Something like Soothe 2, whenever that came out, that absolutely changed everything. Whenever something that powerful comes out, of course, I'm going to put that in my workflow. But a new brick wall limiter that comes out or a new EQ, probably not going to make it into my workflow because I already have things that do everything that I would need. So that's how long I think, you know, if you guys take this course, and you practice over and over and over using this framework, you should get to the point where you could do a mix in 2 hours or less. Sage, I see your discounts on plugins for attending this. Unfortunately, it's not up to me. It's up to the plugin manufacturers. So I had to make, you know, a deal with them that if students show that they were in the Evenant course, they just have to send proof to the manufacturer and then they'll get those discounts. That's the only way that they could do it. I'm sorry. Sam, great question. I actually don't use mix template at all. Now I do have Ableton racks that I've made for myself for like specific things like a vocal, for guitar, for bass. Just saying that out loud, I need one for synths. I don't know, I don't have one. But that's just a starting point. Like it's essentially like a plugin. You know, I'll just go in and click it and it comes into my Ableton session and it's got the plugins I use with the settings that I use and then I tinker from there. But I actually start from a blank slate. Literally the only thing that I have on is my mix bus. And that's just, it's funny, I know, but I don't know. I feel like a session that has nothing in it is just like a blank canvas. And I love the idea of putting the stems in there and just listening to what I'm given. And then going from there, people, you know, that I've worked for in the past, and I know plenty of massive mixers that just put things into their template. You know, they pull in the stems or the multi-track, and then they put them where their template says it should go, and they already have their plugins on there to use. I think that that's great, and that works for a lot of people. And maybe a year from now, I'll be like, oh yeah, now I use a mix template and this and that. But right now it takes me zero time to think, hey, here are guitars. You know what? What I need to do is I need to add a little bit of decapitator. I'm going to need to roll off some of that low end. And then I'm going to need some soothe to take out, you know, the harshness that's coming through the mix. And then I put it in the mix and we're like, ooh, okay, you know what? It would be really cool if I put a little bit of chorus on it to get some wider effect, or I need to put some Haas effect on it. Like, my mind just already goes through the process of what I want to do with the sound, like, so instantaneously that I just let the song tell me what it wants to be, and I don't have a mix template that really guides me. Yeah, Ricky, that's exactly right. He said that you oddly hear the track differently in a mix session versus a writing composing session. You so do. It's because I've been on both sides. I can absolutely tell you that the tracks that I did for albums, where I was able to print the track and then put it in another session, like, I feel like those mixes just come out so much better. Just the fact that you don't see all of the plugins that are in there giving you that sound, or the MIDI or whatever. You are just in a mindset of like, I am just going to elevate what is given to me. Completely changes the way that you hear something. Leaving the room and taking a walk and then coming back into the mix session or something like that will just absolutely flip over the table. And I bet you that you will get to a better result in a mix session. That's just my bet. Zach, his question is, should you aim for -6 LUFS in your mix session, or should that be your target for mastering? So that's a great question. The answer is you should absolutely be aiming for that in your mixing session. And here's why. You need to have your mix bus set up with, you know, a mastering brick wall limiter and everything in your mix session. And you need to make sure that your mix going through that mix bus can get to -7 LUFS or -6 LUFS. Now, trailer music, maybe you'll give some more headroom. Let's say -8 LUFS, okay? But in your mix session, if your mix is not able to get up to those LUFS and sound good, there's no way that you are going to take off that brick wall limiter or take, you know, push into it a little less hard and then send that off to a mastering engineer and have them get it up to the loudness that you want. That is something that needs to be fixed in your mix. This is something that nobody talks about. But if your mix itself cannot get up to those volumes in your session with a brick wall limiter on there, a trained professional mastering engineer is probably not going to be able to do that for you. They can't go back and change your mix. They can change some EQ and whatnot, the imaging, to try and help smack a limiter harder and not get it to distort. But if you can fix that in your mix, and your mix bus and brick wall limiter allow you to get to -7 LUFS, whenever you take off that brick wall limiter and send it out to mastering, you know that you're going to get a great product back. If it can't do that, do not send it out to a mastering engineer. I really highly suggest you fix that in the mix before sending it off. But Zach, yes, this course absolutely dives into mastering. And then to get into the more nitty-gritty of mastering, I have a mastering workshop that comes with the Master the Mix principle. You'll get access to it, and it's going to walk you through mastering much more in depth, where I do not touch the mix. I just do the mastering. So you'll get both sides of that, and you'll really, really understand how to get a track loud. Zach said, speaking of discounts, if we did the fixing the low end workshop, any discount? Unfortunately, no, because it's not a, it has to be an actual course, like where you are a student to get the plug-in discounts. I'm not able to change that. Like, it's not up to me. It's up to the plug-in manufacturers, unfortunately. Sage says, in my environment, I mix a lot in my headphones, and then I check periodically in my speakers. Not ideal, but are there any particular suggestions you have for making that translation smoother? Sage, yeah, the absolute answer to this, unless you have thousands and thousands of dollars to throw at something, which I know a lot of people don't, is to get SonarWorks. That single program will fix your translatability. I mean, it will absolutely night and day change how good your translations go from headphones to monitors to car to, you know, ear pods to whatever it is. Get the SonarWorks that has headphones and monitors, and then that way you can balance your headphones to be flat, and then you can also balance your monitors to be flat, and then you're mixing on headphones, and then you go onto your monitors, and you know that in your room that's pretty close to flat, and then that translation from headphones to monitors should be much more smooth. And I don't know how much Sound ID, it used to be called SonarWorks, but it's Sound ID. I don't know how much that costs, but whatever it is, it's in maybe the $350 or $250 range, but that is the best money that you will probably ever spend for software, straight up, if you want your music to translate. Yeah, so most people think that negative 14 LUFS is standard, which Spotify is just absolutely wrecking people's minds on this. I'm so sorry. I don't know. I do know that it's because they have their normalization settings. But if your track is negative 14 LUFS, it is going to sound so freaking quiet compared to everything else. Like, it does not matter if they have a loudness normalization. Your track is going to sound puny, very quiet. It's not going to sound good at all. And I can put it this way. No mastering engineer, like the big, 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 big pros, the Sterling Mastering masterers, you know, Dale Becker, any of John Greenham, like any of these people are not mastering the, you know, Billie Eilish's and the Beyonce's and the, you know, BTS's and whoever the biggest artists you think, they are not mastering them for negative 14 LUFS, and they do not have a deliverable for Spotify. They are absolutely delivering something in like the negative 6 to negative 8 LUFS range, 100%. So I promise you that the big platforms are not penalizing the biggest artists in the world. They would be killing their platform. The Justin Biebers, the Ariana Grandes, all of these big people are not getting penalized for having this lot of tracks. So throw away the negative 14 thing. Everybody throw that away. Okay. -6, -7, -6 left sounds super hot. I thought Spotify, YouTube do volume normalizations, which into the volume wars. Yeah, so I just covered that. The loudness wars, I don't think that there is a loudness war. It's like big pop music is -6 left to -8 left now. That's where we all are. There are very, very, very loud mixes that are creative, especially like this group, 100 Gex, or Gex, I'm sorry, 100 Gex. If you guys have heard of 100 Gex, like Dylan Brady is getting his stuff to like -2, -3 LUFS, and that is it's like a creative choice. It just sounds like freaking awesome, over the absolute top, slam, distorted. That's his vibe. But the big artists are all in the negative 6 to 8, negative 8 left. Just go buy one of their tracks and check it. It's that loud. So, I mean, it's not super hot. The thing is, it's all relative. Like, if you have a great mix, and the track that I played at the beginning of this, Break Me, is not a great example. Like, it is supposed to be over the top and distorted. That is the vibe of it. But I'm doing like big R&B, ballady, massive tracks that are that loud. It's how you mix it. If you have a very tight low end that is well balanced, the mid range sits nice, the top end isn't harsh, you can smack a limiter really hard, and it just sounds good. I believe that Soothe is an absolute must-have. That plugin is ridiculous. There's nothing, in my opinion, that can do anything like it. Zach, no. I don't have different prints for any kind of platforms. None of the big mastering engineers have different exports. The things that they do have different exports for are vinyl, which is limited much less, maybe no limiting at all sometimes, just compression. So for vinyl, it's different. For all platforms, it's just either a 2448 or a 2496 file that's anywhere from negative 6 to negative 8 lefts generally, and that works for all platforms. The only time that we have different specifications are for Dolby Atmos, and that's a whole different topic. But I don't print anything different. I don't print anything different for publishers. If I'm having somebody else master my mixes, which happens on like major label albums, like if somebody's doing the overall album, some, like, generally they'll have, you know, a big mastering engineer do it. And, you know, I get to see all these deliverables every time that I send something out, and there's absolutely not a different export. The artist that puts stuff out at negative 2 lufs, I'll type it in here, it's 100 gecs. 100 gecs. And it's hyperpop. I mean, it's super cool. It's a vibe and a half. Like, you're either into it or you're not. I definitely like it. I think it's very inventive and very different. And it's certainly pushing the bar to be creative, which I'm all for. I'm doing a whole bunch of hyperpop stuff with some artists right now. None that's out just yet, but I think I have a lot coming out. Yeah, so Sam, there actually, Sound ID has I forgot what it's called, but it's like, you can do it overall your computer, which is the one I suggest. So basically all audio sources go through SonarWorks. This is kind of the key to actually using it, in my opinion. You should listen to literally all music from your computer, your gaming, your Spotify, your YouTube, whatever, movies, through SonarWorks. That way you know exactly what SonarWorks sounds like the way that things should sound flat. If you're only doing it in your DAW, you're missing like more than half of the possibility of learning what things should sound like. So in that sense, you actually don't have to turn it off before you bounce it, because it's external from your DAW. You guys should absolutely do that. And I forgot what it's called. System-wide? It's called SonarWorks System-wide. I don't use it anymore. I have expensive boxes called mini DSP units, and it's essentially like sonar works, but like actual and like gear. So my audio path goes through them and then the sound comes out of my speakers, but they're like analog hardware. They're not analog. I guess it's software based, but hardware EQing and phase aligning. It does what SonarWorks does, but it's just, maybe it just costs more. I don't even know if it does, you know, something that much better. SonarWorks is crazy good. Thanks, Andreas. Yeah, your music's killer, dude. Yeah, the system-wide version of SonarWorks is, that's the key. You should literally listen to everything you can through it. Same with your headphones. Like, if they had an app for your phone, I would go so far as to say, like, you should listen to everything through the SonarWorks app into your studio headphones. That way, you know, whenever you're at the gym or whenever you're on a walk or you're wherever, you're listening to the way that that EQ curve sounds. That way you train your ear to know whenever you're mixing your music that it translates through SonarWorks the same way as everything else. Sergio, so basically what Sam was saying is that if you put SonarWorks does have a, you know, like a plugin version that you can put in your DAW. And so if you were to use that, it needs to be the very last thing on your chain. I actually set up a mix bus channel. That's where all my plugins are on. So if I used Sound ID in my DAW, it would be on my literal master bus. And whenever you're printing, you need to turn that off, because it would like EQ and phase change your music, which is not what you want. You just want to hear it translate through the plugin so that it optimizes for your room, but you don't actually want that EQing on your music, because it's only to make your room flat, if that makes sense. That's why if you use the system-wide setting, it's way better. That way, you don't have to turn it on and off, and then you can monitor everything through it. David asked a cool question. Do you approach mixing trailer orchestral music differently from pop music? So yeah, I mean, there are different like mindsets and some different approaches to mixing those two genres, but the framework is the exact same. So in this course, I'm teaching the framework, and then I dive into the genres and show how I mix those. But the framework's the same. The things that do change, though, is that, one, we're definitely not getting trailer music quite as loud as pop music. Simple enough. But I work from the third act of a trailer, get that sounding great, and then I go back to the first act, and then I move forward from there in time. With the pop track, I will start with the chorus, or maybe the second chorus, whatever the biggest moment of the track is, and then I'll work back from there. So it's kind of the same, but a little bit different. And then, you know, in trailer music, I don't think that we want as tight of a low end as we do in pop music. We want it to rumble a little bit. We want those big hits and stuff to rumble and have room for that, because, you know, we hope that they get placed in trailers. And ultimately, we hope that they are the trailer that plays in the actual theater. I mean, that's as cool as it gets. And you want that rumbly, massive low end. You want that to feel larger than life. In a pop track, we want it like very scalpel clean on the low end, because if it plays on radio, we want all car systems to be able to handle that low end. Other things, I would say that we want to sink into a trailer mix more. So what I mean by this is like the middle of the mix, we don't want to be as in our face. We kind of want, like, if we think of this like as a U, We want a trailer to be more like a U, where it wraps around our body. It's more cinematic to have things wide and wrap around us, and the drums to kind of sink back in the mix, but still have all their punch and stuff, but just not be absolutely in your face. That way, it just, in my mind, it's more like a, it's a better way to tell a story where you're like immersed in the mix. With pop music, we want the vocal to definitely be out in our face, and then, you know, drums to sit behind that and be like a little bit wider, but still, you know, crush and hit hard. But we still want it to wrap around us, but I think of it more in the, I don't know, like the inverted U, kind of where it's the vocal sitting in our face. So it's just like the depth of the mix. I think trailers should be more surrounding of your body. And I really teach how to do that in this course. I think that's kind of one of my signatures, is making a mix wrap around your body and having this immersive feel to it. Michael, have you had any experience with baby audio smooth operator as opposed to soothe? No, I haven't used smooth operator. I may have tried it one time, but I cannot tell you that I have any real experience with it. So unfortunately, I don't know. Soothe does everything that I would want it to, but maybe I'm missing out. Sage, I have Dear VR monitor for the translation between headphones and speakers. Does SonarWorks do the same in DAW setting? I actually haven't used the Dear VR monitor. I've definitely used their binaural panner, which is freaking incredible. And I love it. But Sage, I'll just tell you what SonarWorks does, and you can tell me. So for the monitor part of it, you have an Omni mic, like an Earthworks type mic. Put it on a stand, or you hold it in your hand actually, and the program tells you like where to walk in the room and hold the mic. And then it figures out, like, you know, this side of the room has this kind of build up and this has this build up, and it basically EQs the signal that's going to come out of your monitors to make your room sound flat and make up for any lack or too much of certain frequencies. And then in headphones, you tell it what kind of headphones you have, and they have already created an EQ and phase algorithm so that your headphones play flat. And then what you could do is in the Sound ID program, you could just go, you click back and forth between headphones and monitors, and that's how you do that. Zach, so he said, another question about SonarWorks. When you bounce your track after mixing, you're supposed to disable the plugin, but then it's way quieter. Is that normal, or am I doing something wrong? Well, it sounds like you have the makeup gain on SonarWorks cranked up. So yes, this is a thing. This is why I use the system-wide setting, because it doesn't deal in volume. I mean, it has its own makeup gain inside of it, because maybe you're losing some volume because it's doing some EQ correction. But if it's system-wide, you know, exactly what you print will be the exact volume that's going to play back on your computer. But if you have it in your DAW, yeah, I mean, it's affecting what's going into your master. Yeah, that's exactly why I would never use it in my DAW, because you don't want anything after your brick wall limiter. Like, no matter what, that's changing what's going to come out of your DAW. I would just use it system-wide. That's for sure the way to go. Yeah, Neil said, can you talk a little bit about any personal unique approach to EDM music and other club music? For sure. So it's not out yet, but it's been teased enough that I could talk about it. Recently, I did a song that's got Said the Sky on it. The artist's friend, who is the amazing producer, Andrew Goldstein. And it's got Lil Aaron as vocals. And then it's Said the Sky on the drops. And yeah, I mean, it's the mindset for me behind mixing EDM stuff, which I've done a whole lot of. It just, there's not much of it out just yet. It's all, mixing is an interesting thing. I'd sometimes mix stuff a year before it comes out, and that's kind of the case with a lot right now. But the whole idea behind EDM music, again, is I'm shooting for like -6 luf. There are people that get much louder than that. My buddy Effin, JD, will get up to like -4, and that just works for his style. Like, he loves that. But their precision is key. So a kick that has too much low end and a subline that's massive are not going to work together. So I'm always making sure that the sustain of the kick is not too long and that there's not too much low end, but it has a good knock to it. And that way we make room for the sub. The sub, you know, should be all the low information, and it shouldn't fight with the knock of the kick. So maybe we're going to do like an instantaneous sidechain where it just ducks for like 20 milliseconds so that knock can come through of the kick. And then the rest of the sustain is the sub. And then like on any of the synths or stuff like that in a chorus or the drop, you know, I try and get them wide and is covering as much ground as possible, but making sure that it has no low end, so that sub can be freaking huge. And one thing that I definitely like to do is I absolutely love to chorus my bass. A lot of people just always try and keep stuff mono. But what I'll do is I'll make a parallel, and I talk about this in the course, how to do it. I make a parallel of the sub, and I make it super wide, but I take out all of the low end and the high end, and it's just like the mid-range. And I will sprinkle in enough of that that the low end just really feels like it wraps around the full mix. Because like I said, low mids are directional. Like, I can hear low mids in the left and in the right. With sub information, you can't like geolocate where it's coming from. So, you know, that can be mono or whatever, but I want to make sure that low mids and in mids have some kind of width and direction to them. And it just adds excitement to the mix. Those are some things that I really do for electronic music, and just make sure that the drums just freaking bang. You know, saturation. Saturation is king. Sergio, I don't apply to publishers as a mix engineer. I want to say that pretty much everything that I've done, I would say that every single publisher that I have worked for was word of mouth. They either saw my posting online, people talking about the work that I have done. I maybe in the very, very beginning, I messaged people that I'd love to take a shot at mixing some of their stuff. But pretty much after that, it was just word of mouth, which I think just speaks to everybody. Like, if you do good work and you treat people kindly and they know that they can rely on you, then they're going to tell somebody else about the work that you do. And that's my goal, is just to work, you know, do great work and be as friendly as possible and easy to work with, and hopefully be friends with the people I work with. I think that I've been in this industry too long and have dealt with a lot of people that were not awesome. And all I want to do is work with really great and friendly people. So I just try and give that out. Like, that's who I am. And luckily, work keeps on coming in from like-minded people. I'm going to have to cut this off shortly here. Although, I mean, we're getting some great questions now. DRVR definitely does not do that for speakers. Okay. Eric, any good approaches or steps to EQing synths with within a hybrid orchestral piece. I think the first question is, like, are these synths present? Like, are we supposed to hear them in the mix? Like, are they a prominent element? And if they are, then generally my rule of thumb is that if I can, I won't reach for an EQ for boosting. And it doesn't have anything to do with the age old, like, it sounds worse. Like, the algorithm sounds worse if you boost as opposed to cut. It really has to do with, an EQ is only adding volume to an area. It's not actually adding any thickness or any new information. So what I'll do is I'll use a saturator like Spectre, and I'll choose an area that I want a synth to poke out in, and I'll use the saturator to lightly saturate that area to poke out in the mix, as opposed to using an EQ. And vice versa, I will absolutely use an EQ if, like, synths aren't supposed to be present in the mix. They're just supposed to add, like, extra energy and thickness. I will bring down the volume of that synth to where it feels right volume-wise with what it's supposed to layer with. And then I'll figure out what is the main element. What is the EQ area that I want to stick out in that main element? And then I'll cut back just a little bit on that area on the synth. So maybe, let's say it's some kind of staccato strings, okay? And we have some cool little ARP that's playing the same line under it. I will maybe in that case take the 1K area down slightly in the synth to make room for the staccato strings. And maybe vice versa, like, I'll put Spectre on those short strings, and I might just boost a little bit around the 1K area on those strings just to have them cut through. So I reach for a saturator if I'm trying to add harmonic content to a sound, and I'll reach for an EQ generally whenever I want to dip something. That's not a hard and fast rule. Sometimes everything is there that you need in a sound, you just boost it with EQ. And if it's more, like, it's more simple, you already have an EQ up, maybe you reach for that. But in theory, using a little bit of saturation is going to be better, and I try to do that as much as possible. Michael, I don't really use track spacer at all. I have at times, and I have it. I don't know. I can tell you this. I've sent my work off to clients, and I will just use, like, barely any of it. And a lot of the clients that I work with, like, really great producers, will be like, hey, do you have track spacer on that thing by chance? Like, I can hear something. And it's just not, it's not the tool that I usually reach for. I'll just say that. David, I have two saturators that I love. Pretty much only two. Spectre, which is one of my newest tools. Out of this world amazing saturator. It's a multi-band saturation tool that kind of looks like a parametric EQ. It's amazing. If you want to choose, like, a specific frequency range that you want to boost, reach for Spectre. So especially if it's, like, low end, a thump on a kick, a vocal that you just want to push through just slightly, Spectre. It's incredible. If an overall sound is not giving you the life and energy and thickness and excitement that you want, decapitator. Put it on the E setting and just give it a little bit of love. Not much. That's going to thicken the overall sound. It's going to give you that excitement, that little bit of top end that just will cut through the mix better. That's an overall big paintbrush that I use all the time. And then you can use the tone knob and turn it to kind of, like, harness a little bit. It's like a tilt knob. It's like less top end, more low end, and vice versa. So those are the only two saturators I use. And I think that you could get any result pretty much with those two. You know, do whatever you would like. But I think that the less plugins you use, the better. Neil, let's make this. Okay. Well, let's answer these and then we'll hop off. So to get a big and wide EDM sound, I get it. Like that could take, like 10 years of time to learn how to do. I think that there's some incredible YouTube videos out there that can teach you how to layer synths and basses and whatnot to get that big, wide sound. I think that that's honestly less about the mixer and about the production itself. For me, I can make things bigger and wider through what I talked about earlier with vocal parallel widening. So there's some cool synths that I'll do that with. Like if something's already big and wide, I probably won't touch it. But if something is really narrow and I want to get it a little bit of width, I will use like parallel chorus, parallel widening with an H3000 or that Dimension D, or even that the Waves, what is it called? The stereo doubler or quad doubler. That one is a little sketch. I can hear the chorusing pretty early in that. So I just put just a little bit, and it kind of adds this subtle thickness to the mix, which I think is cool. But whenever you start doing like mid-side EQ, like crazy heavy mid-side EQ, you really start to mess with the phase of the track, which could be like cool and a certain sound and texture to your mix. That's great. But if you're not going for that, I think stereo widening with like actual wideners themselves on the actual signal, it's going to take away all the power from a mix. Okay, let's see. Let's make this the last question, yeah? Okay, what do you think of saturation in the master chain, even if it's really, really just a sprinkle? I absolutely am not into that, to be honest. I know a lot of people who do. A lot of people use like a tape emulation plugin and just have just a little bitty bit. If that's the vibe you're going for, cool. And who am I to say that that's wrong? That could totally be right. And I think it is right. For me, I really like dialing that sound into the mix itself. So I think the question is like, what are you actually trying to add there? Because if it's gel to the track, the mix bus that I use already gives you the gel. And the gel is actually the interweaving of elements in a mix, like their volume, their panning, their EQ, their compression, stuff like that. If it's you're trying to add a little bit of saturation and grit to the overall track, well, which elements of the track do you want to add that to? And then you could just go into those elements and add a little bit. You know, I think that leaving your mix bus to just do the loudness and the overall gel of the track is kind of what the mix bus is for. But I think that that right there is a great segue to just say the course that I've created for you guys, it's a framework for you to take a mix from zero to finished and know what step comes next and plugins to use to get there that I use daily, like the literal plugins that I use. But then those are kind of just like if we're at a bowling alley, those are just like the bumpers. And it's like, if you get too far off the course, boom, you hit that bumper. And now, you know, this is what we do next. We go back to this other bumper. But everything in between is you and the choices that you make and the ear that you develop and the childhood that you had and the music you listened to then and the video games that you listened to growing up and whatnot. And, you know, like those influences and sounds that you love, the parts of the world that you live in that give you a certain different ear and aspect to a mix. You know, you use the framework and tools that I tell you about, and then you choose what your sound is. And that's not to say, like, this course will give you a sound. There's no doubt about that. But once you do this framework over and over and over, you're going to find that you gravitate towards specific settings more often than you do others, or plugins that you want to incorporate into this framework. And so if that's a saturator over a full mix, hell yeah, you know, that's not wrong just because I don't do it. All right. So thanks for joining us today, or me, I suppose. And again, I really thank you for being here. And if you are getting the course, if you have gotten the course, I put all the time and effort and love and craft honing and years of knowledge that I have currently into this course. So, you know, I know it works for me. This is literally what I do every day. This is how I do it. If you get the course and you want to reach out, there's a group that you can chat with me in. You can post anything in there. I'll answer it. I'm an open book. I'll help out, you know, in whichever ways I can. And then I'm also going to be launching at some point, like one-on-one teaching with Evenant. And then also the ability to use my mixing and mastering practices. You'll be able to order, you know, a mix, a master, or both of them combined on the Evenant platform. You know, sometimes that's just great if you're pitching to a publisher for the first time and you want to make sure that it sounds as good as possible. I'm here for that to help you. Any thoughts, you know, questions, concerns, anything that you put in that group chat, I will read them. And if you have suggestions on things that I should do in the future or things that I should change about the course, again, I'm super down to do that. This is a course that I want to stand the test of time, and we can update it and make it as good as possible in the future. But for now, I think it is absolutely incredible, and it's gonna 100% elevate wherever you are now to, you know, something that you probably can't even perceive that you could do. So with that being said, I will see you in the course. All right. Bye, guys.